Let's turn now to Exploring the Shema, Discussions on the Issues of Trinity, and we are picking up again our study in this little chart that Karim put together. So let me just read this little section right here once more. We looked at this last week. Karim's Trinity chart of scriptural passages is what we're going to be working our way down through for the next several weeks. The chart below should help you to see how the doctrine of the Trinity is systematically derived from scripture. The list is not exhaustive, only illustrative. And the point I'm trying to make is, as using the tools that I've been helping us with along the way, some of them kind of confusing at times, but the point I'm trying to bring up is that the Bible is a book that is full of information, but it's not always laid out in the structure that best promotes our own modern way of articulating and forming the ideas and conclusions that we come to. So that's not to say that the Bible is incomplete or that it is deficient in any way. It's simply to say that the Bible was structured in a way that God ordained, and it was penned by men, and it poured through their mind and their thought processes, and God utilized the writers' concepts of that day, which were Hebrews, to help describe what he wants mankind to walk away with. So it is a complete revelation of God, and it lacks nothing, and it is the final authority in all matters. But yet it's not enough. Maybe it was in the 70s or 80s, but it's not enough today simply said that the Bible's truth stands on its own and doesn't need to be defended or doesn't need to be articulated. I firmly believe that God expects us to take what he has given us and to investigate it thoroughly, and then to explain as best we can to others what the findings that we have arrived at. Indeed, that's what other biblical writers did in their day. For instance, say Stephen in the book of Acts, when he's being challenged by the mob just before he got stoned by them, right just before they picked up stones and put him to death, they murdered him. He relayed the story of Israel through the Tanakh. The point I'm trying to make is that he simply didn't, in his day, for him to convey the truth of what he was trying to convey to them, the story of Israel's history, he didn't simply just quote the Tanakh verbatim and leave it. He quoted copious parts of it, but he provided his own commentary along the way. And indeed, Paul does the same thing. He quotes a passage and then he explains what he thinks it means or what he believes it means by the power of the Holy Spirit. So I don't think we're in bad company. I don't think we're doing the wrong thing by taking a passage and then explaining as best we can in our own words to someone else what this passage means. That's not wrong. If we just said, well, if you want to understand what the Bible says, go ahead and read it for yourself and then stop. I think that can work for some people, but it certainly doesn't work for many people. And so I'm hoping that this exercise will give us tools necessary to read the passages and start there, and then realize that that's both the starting and the end point, but in the middle, during our investigation, we're going to use other resources to help us understand what the text means. And so let's avail ourselves of these other tools. So having said all of that, let's look at this chart real quick. Last week we looked at Father is called God in Philippians 1:2. I'll look at the passage in a second. We looked at Son is called God in John 1:1 and 1:14, and Colossians 2:9, and we looked at the Holy Spirit is called God in Acts 5:3 and 4. And so tonight, and then last week, that was the short answer was we looked at all three of those passages about being called God, right? That we looked at all of those references under Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And then for the short answer, we looked at all of them, but in the longer answer, I concentrated only on Father called God in Philippians. But tonight, let's focus on the Son is called God, and we'll start, we'll briefly just look at Philippians, but then we'll mostly focus on the John passages here as well. Because the Son is not called God in Philippians, right? The Father is. So we're going to basically focus on today. The Son is called God in John 1:1, 1:14. Whether we get to the Colossians 2:9 passage tonight is, I don't know. We might just spend all of our time on the John 1:1, 1:14 because there's so much there. And we might even make this two parts this week and next week just because of the nature of John's prologue itself is so packed with information. I would do it a disservice by trying to focus on do it all in the next 10 or 15 minutes. So we'll see how long this goes.
We'll be right back.